Good morning, everybody. I'm going to talk on hemodynamic calculations by echocardiography. When we do the echocardiography, we get a lot of functional information about systolic function, diastolic function, valvular function, wall motion study. But at the same time, we can get various hemodynamic information regarding hemodynamic function by doing simple calculations, which are very much necessary in the intensive care setting for diagnostic purpose, for guiding interventions and therapy, and also to monitor and follow up the patients. While doing M-mode and 2D echocardiography, we get various signs which are suggestive of hemodynamic abnormalities, like in aortic regurgitation, we get fluttering of mitral valve, which we know gives rise to Austin Flint murmur. In dynamic LVOT obstruction, we get a mid-systolic aortic valve closure. In pulmonary hypertension, we get mid-systolic pulmonary valve closure. If there is increased RV systolic pressure, we get dilated RV and D-shaped LV. Increased RA pressure is indicated by dilated IVC, lack of inspiratory collapse. And increased LA pressure will give rise to the persistent bowing of the IAS to RA. And in case of increased RA pressure, bowing will be towards LA. And in presence of pericardial effusion, if there is diastolic RARV collapse, we give a diagnosis of cardiac tamponade. But we must remember all these findings are very non-specific, and they give indirect evidences of hemodynamic abnormalities. Since the introduction of Doppler echocardiography, we are in a position to give specific and direct information regarding stroke volume, cardiac output, pressure gradient at any site of obstruction in the heart, valve area, intracardiac pressures, pulmonary arterial pressures, LV filling pressure, and also we can calculate the regurgitant volume. So out of all hemodynamic calculations, we are always worried about cardiac output. It's a source of concern in the intensive care unit, in the postoperative, preoperative patients, because it is the primary determinant of oxygen supply to the body from the heart. A low cardiac output is always detrimental. And in the intensive care unit, those who cannot maintain a cardiac index, if the cardiac index is below 2 liters per minute per square meter of the body surface, they have a very high mortality rate. And often these patients have a very low cardiac output and respond immediately to the fluid therapy, fluid resuscitation. So we must know what is stroke volume and what is cardiac output. As you know, stroke volume is the amount of the blood pumped out per beat. And the cardiac output is the amount of the blood pumped out per minute. So cardiac output, which is expressed in liters per minute, is the stroke volume multiplied by heart rate. And cardiac index is the cardiac output divided by body surface area, expressed in liters per minute per square meter of body surface. Now, how do we calculate the stroke volume? These are the simple calculations. There are certain steps and very easy to understand. Don't think that these are very tough. See, a flow across a fixed orifice, there is a definite formula for it given by physics people. It's the cross-sectional area of that orifice multiplied by flow velocity. So cross-sectional area is equal to pi r square. We know the value of pi, and we have to get the value of r. Now see, heart, we, for our convenience of calculation, we assume that the orifice of the heart is a circle, because, and we measure the diameter, because it is difficult to measure the radius. So it's much easier to measure the diameter. So we convert this formula into pi multiplied by d by 2 square, because radius is half of the diameter. So ultimately it comes like this, pi d square by 4. So ultimately d square multiplied by 0.785. So stroke volume is this multiplied by flow velocities. So while taking the flow velocity, instead of taking peak velocity, we trace the spectrum and we take the velocity time integral. Why? Because heart is a pulsatile system, cardiovascular system is a pulsatile system, and the ejection varies from time to time. So instead of taking velocity at one point, we integrate the entire area under the spectrum and measure the velocity time integral. So ultimately the formula, stroke volume is equal to d square multiplied by 0.0785 multiplied by VTI. Now, out of all the orifices of the heart, where do we measure the stroke volume? See, stroke volume can be measured at any valve, all four valves of the heart, provided there is no regurgitation and there is no shunt. It will be same in all the orifices, but we measure it across the LVOT or the aortic valve. Why? Because the flow at the LVOT is laminar, and it is very easy for us to measure the LVOT diameter. So these are the two things we will be needing in the formula. So we can measure the stroke volume in two steps. In step 1, we measure the LVOT diameter. In step 2, we measure the LVOT VDI. While measuring the LVOT diameter, we go to the mid-esophageal aortic long axis view or upper esophageal long axis view in transesophageal echo and left parasternal long axis view in transthoracic echo. Now, while taking this measurement, we must remember a technical consideration which is given by the latest guideline in Journal of American Society of Echocardiography in 2017, that LVOT should always be measured into the zoom mode. So you zoom the view and measure it in mid-systole and measure it 5 to 10 millimeter from the aortic annulus, because annulus is a measurement from hinge point to the hinge point, but LVOT is a bit down from there, it's 5 to 10 millimeter. So you measure here. There we go. This is the long axis view, mid-esophageal long axis view. We freeze, then we zoom it and measure the LVOT. And this way we get the LVOT diameter of 1.6 centimeter. Now what about the VTI? For VTI, we go to the transgastric view. In transgastric view, as you go to 120 to 130 degree, you get a view like this. This is the LV, aortic valve, and the aorta. So this is the LVOT. Clearly you can see the flow across the LVOT. You get the cursor, place the sample volume at 5 to 10 millimeter distance from the annulus and get the pulse wave Doppler. As you do the pulse wave Doppler, you get a tracing like this and you trace it. As you trace it, you will get a VTI. In this case, the VTI is 15.1 centimeter. And you see, if you do these steps correctly, the machine itself will give all the informations like stroke volume, cardiac output. However, you must know which are the values you have to take and fit the machine. So in this case, it's the LVOT diameter and the LV outflow tract pulse wave Doppler VTI. Clear? These are the two steps. Very easy to do. Machine will give it. In this case, the stroke volume is 30.34 ml. So cardiac output will be this multiplied by 127, that is his heart rate. So 3.8 liters per minute. Very easy to do. Two steps. Now we have a patient who is 65 years old coming to us with chest pain, shortness of breath, repeated syncope. On auscultation, you hear a systolic murmur and ECG shows the left ventricular hypertrophy. And you do the echo, transesophageal echo in mid-esophageal long axis view. You see a lot of turbulence near the aortic valve. And you know this is due to aortic stenosis. Stenosis has increased the velocity of the blood cells. Now with a very simple calculation, you can convert this velocity to gradient and you can comment on the severity of the stenosis of the aortic valve. How? It is by using modified Bernoulli equation, which says the pressure gradient is equal to 4 into V square. So you have to get the velocity across the aortic valve. See, I haven't taken the velocity in the mid-esophageal long axis because to get the velocity, a vital thing is your cursor should be near parallel to the flow across the aortic valve. So I go to the transgastric view at 120 degree, I see this aortic valve and I put the color flow. Now if I get the cursor here, my cursor will be absolutely parallel to the flow, forward flow. And I get a gradient, I do the CW continuous wave Doppler because the aortic valve has a very high velocity because of the stenosis, and I get a tracing like this, and the peak velocity comes to 4.74 centimeter per second. Using modified Bernoulli equation, the peak gradient comes to 90 millimeter of mercury, which signifies a very severe aortic stenosis. See, not only the peak gradient, it is possible to get the mean gradient also. How do you do that? You trace it, trace this spectrum starting from the beginning, go round and round up to the end, and you get a mean gradient which is 57 millimeter of mercury. This is the average of the gradient. Now this gradient is very accurate because it correlates well with the catheter induced gradient. So we always take the mean gradient while commenting on the aortic valve stenosis. Any gradient more than 40 millimeter, mean gradient, I mean more than 40 millimeter of mercury indicates severe aortic stenosis. So we have converted the velocity into gradient and we have commented on the severity of the aortic stenosis. By another calculation, we can also comment on the severity of the aortic stenosis, which is called dimensionless index. Dimensionless index is the ratio of the alveolar VTI and aortic valve VTI. See, normally the ratio should be 1. Why? Because whatever goes in must come out. Whatever goes through the LV outflow tract must come out through the aortic valve also. So the ratio should be 1. If there is aortic stenosis, the ratio will be altered. It will be less than 1. In severe aortic stenosis, it is less than 0.25, in moderate 0.25 to 0.50, and in mild aortic stenosis, it is more than 0.50. How do we calculate this dimensionless index? Very easy, by two steps. In step one, we measure the LVOT VTI from pulse wave Doppler at LVOT as I have shown in stroke volume. And in step two, we'll measure the aortic valve VTI from CW Doppler across the aortic valve, as I have shown while taking the gradient across aortic valve. So for that, I go to the transgastric view. I place the sample volume in the LVOT, get the pulse wave Doppler, get this pattern, measure the VTI. I have already explained this. And in the next step, in the same view, I do the continuous wave Doppler across the aortic valve, and I get a VTI across the aortic valve. So now here I got 11.2, here across the aortic valve the VTI is 88.8 centimeter. So the ratio comes to 0.12. which goes to severe aortic stenosis. And there is another one more calculation for commenting on the severity of the aortic valve, aortic stenosis. Again, by using the same principle, what goes in must come out of the aortic valve. So obviously, stroke volume at LVOT should be equal to the stroke volume at aortic valve. Now we are already expert in calculating the stroke volume at LVOT by using the formula LVOT area into LVOT VTI, and stroke volume at aortic valve is aortic valve area multiplied by aortic valve VTI. So ultimately, aortic valve area is equal to this divided by aortic valve VTI. Here we will need three steps to measure. Step 1, we measure LVOT diameter, we have already learnt. Step 2, we measure the LVOT VTI, we have already learnt by pulse wave Doppler. And step 3, measurement of aortic VTI, aortic valve VTI by CW Doppler. These also we know. So measurement of LVOT by following the AEC guidelines, latest guidelines, we get 1.9 centimeter. And then we go to the transgastric view, we do the pulse wave Doppler with sample volume in the LVOT, trace it, get the LVOT VTI, we do the continuous wave Doppler across aortic valve and trace it, we get the aortic valve VTI. So the aortic valve area, after putting the values in the formula, aortic valve area turns out to be 0.52 square centimeter. So any valve area below 1 square centimeter is considered to be severe aortic stenosis. In the same way, you can get gradient across the VST. This is the again mid-esophageal long axis view. This is LV, this is RV. As you can see, there is a small VST through which there is a left to right flow. Look, the color is blue, so it's left to right. It's going away from the transducer, and I place the cursor and get a gradient of velocity of 4.7 by utilizing the modified Bernoulli equation. The machine gives a gradient of 88 millimeter of mercury. So this 88 millimeter of mercury is the pressure difference between LV and RV, right? So from this, it is possible to estimate the right ventricular systolic pressure also. How do you do that? So right ventricular systolic, this pressure gradient across VSD is the difference between LV and RV systolic pressure. So RV systolic pressure will be LV systolic pressure minus pressure gradient at VSD. So what is LV systolic pressure? Is the patient's systolic blood pressure. Say suppose this is 120 millimeter of mercury, systolic blood pressure, minus 88. So 32 is the right ventricular systolic pressure of this patient. If there is no pulmonary valve stenosis or RVOT obstruction, these will reflect the pulmonary arterial systolic pressure. Next, let us go to from the aortic valve and VSD, let us move to the mitral valve area by pressure half-time method. Now, what is pressure half-time? Pressure half-time is the time required for the pressure gradient to decline to half of its initial peak value. Now, there is a formula which is given by the physics people. Mitral valve area is equal to, in square centimeters, 220 divided by pressure half time. This 220 is a constant figure and this is variable, pressure half time. How do we do that? We go to the mid-esophageal four chamber view with the color flow, get the cursor. Cursor should be near parallel to the flow, that is a must, otherwise you will not get the accurate pressure half time, and you get the spectral pattern. It looks like this across the mitral valve. So we measure the pressure half time by placing the caliper at the peak and follow the deceleration, this decline, and we second point it will be at the bottom of the line. So this way the machine calculates using this formula. The machine gives a mitral valve area of 1.28 square centimeter, which is moderate. See, the anterior mitral valve is opening partially. It's not very tight. What about this case? Here, look, the stenosis is further severe. And we measure the pressure half time and it turns out to be 0.75 square centimeter, which signifies severe mitral valve stenosis. So it's not very easy. Only you have to find out the pressure half time. And a very important thing is to make the cursor parallel to the flow. Though right heart catheterization is the gold standard for estimating the pulmonary arterial pressures, but echocardiography also is a non-invasive bedside method. It gives useful information regarding the pulmonary arterial pressures. We can estimate systolic, diastolic, mean pulmonary arterial pressure. Even we can estimate the severity by using tricuspid regurgitation, pulmonary regurgitation, and pulmonary flow acceleration time. So let us see how we calculate, how we use tricuspid regurgitation. There it's a mid-esophageal view, RV inflow, outflow almost. I'm at around 98 degree. My aim is to make the cursor parallel to the tricuspid regurgitation. This is the tricuspid valve regurgitation. It's going from RA to LA. Sorry, from RV to RA. And I get a TR velocity of 3.35 meter per second. So machine utilizes this velocity and gives a peak gradient of 45 millimeter of mercury. So this 45 millimeter of mercury is the pressure difference between RV and RA, right? So right ventricular systolic pressure will be this pressure difference plus the RA pressure. So peak TR gradient is 45 millimeter of mercury, and we have to calculate the RA pressure to get the RV systolic pressure. And in absence of pulmonary valve stenosis, RVOT obstruction, this RV systolic pressure reflects the pulmonary arterial systolic pressure. So how do you measure the RA pressure? All of you know that by looking at the IVC. This I have taken from transthoracic echo, subcostal view, IVC draining into the RA. This is very much essential. You don't only visualize the IVC, you must be able to visualize the drainage of the IVC into the RA, because in the postoperative patients, often aorta is confused as the IVC if it is dilated. So be careful while looking at the IVC regarding this point. So this IVC is small in size, collapsing, and before commenting on the collapsibility, please ask the patient to sniff if it is if the patient is conscious, and then only you comment on the collapsibility. Normally the diameter is less than 2.1 centimeter, and collapsibility with the sniffing is more than 50%. If it is so, we say that RA pressure is 3 with range of 0 to 5 millimeter of mercury. If it is more than 2.1 centimeter, as in this case, and collapsibility is less than 50%, as here it's almost like tram line, it's the RA pressure is 15 millimeter of mercury with a range of 10 to 20 millimeter. Can I continue? One more minute. Okay. So we know the RA pressure. Using the PR jet, you can calculate the diastolic pulmonary artery pressure. This is the end diastole of PR at the RA pressure with it. And using the peak PR jet gradient, if you add the RA pressure, you get the mean pulmonary arterial pressure. Using the acceleration time of pulmonary forward flow, you can estimate the mean pulmonary arterial pressure. Normally, it is more than 130 milliseconds. You measure the acceleration time. If it is less than 100 millisecond, it indicates PH. I think I'll tell about the filling pressure. Okay. We need to estimate the filling pressure because it leads to heart failure, and it helps to optimize our unloading therapy, and it's an important marker of poor prognosis in the heart failure. Moreover, in the latest guidelines, the grading of diastolic dysfunction is done based on LV filling pressure. So how do we do that? And out of many various measurements which can give us the idea about LV filling pressure, E by E prime is the best one, because it has been seen that there is a linear correlation between pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and E by E prime ratio. So how do we do that? We go to the mid-esophageal four chamber view, place the cursor and the sample volume in between the tip of the mitral valve leaflets, and get the pulse wave Doppler. So we get E wave and A wave. This is the E wave is the early rapid filling phase, A is the late rapid filling phase. So we know the velocity of E wave. Then we go to the tissue Doppler imaging mode, which colorizes the tissues in the heart. Instead of blood cells, we will take the velocities of the tissues, and in this case the mitral annular velocity. Look, this is the anterior leaflet, and it here is the septal annulus, and this is the lateral annulus. First, we place the sample volume in the septal annulus or the medial annulus, whatever you say, and we get the spectral pattern. Annulus moves towards the apex during systole, and it moves away from the apex during the diastole. During systole, it's below the waistline. Diastole, the early rapid filling phase, E prime. And late rapid filling phase, A prime. So we know the velocity of E prime. Now we can take the ratio of E by E prime in the septal annulus, and then we go to the lateral annulus. Same way we do the pulse wave Doppler, we get E prime and A prime. We take the ratio of E by E prime. We take the average of these two ratios, and if that average ratio is less than 10, then it indicates normal LV filling pressure, and if it is more than 14, it indicates increased LV filling pressure. So it can be done in three steps. I think should I go, should I continue or stop? Can I continue? Okay. So are you enjoying? Thank you. So it's very easy to calculate the average E by E prime. Okay. So these are the three steps only, and all the machines are having tissue Doppler imaging. Very easy to calculate. But always take the average E by E prime, because often you know the velocities varies from medial to lateral. So take the average. Now I'll go to the RV index of myocardial performance. Many students carry the studies using the TIE index. So I think if there are students, it will be helpful for them. So the global index, it is a global index of both systolic and diastolic function. The formula is isovolumic contraction time plus isovolumic relaxation time divided by ejection time. Now see, here the tricuspid valve opens, E wave, A wave closes, and there is a gap. Then tricuspid valve opens again here. So tricuspid valve is closing here and it's opening here. This is the tricuspid closure to opening time. Now in this period there are three things. One is the ejection, because systole occurs here. Before systole, there is a period which is isovolumic contraction time, and after the ejection, there is a period called isovolumic relaxation time. So, if we can measure the tricuspid closure to opening time, and again we can measure the ejection time, Then if we subtract ejection time from tricuspid closure to opening time, we get the value of IVCT and IVRT. Clear? So the formula goes like this: tricuspid closure to opening time minus ejection time divided by ejection time. The utilizing this formula, we can deduct the RV index of myocardial performance by using pulse wave Doppler as well as by using tissue Doppler at the lateral annulus. So first let us see how we utilize pulse wave Doppler. So that is the image which I have already explained. We need to measure the tricuspid closure to opening time. See, this is the again that mid-esophageal 110 degree view, keeping the sample volume at the level of the tip of tricuspid valve leaflets. I get the spectral pattern. Here is the E wave, A wave. Tricuspid valve closes. Again, it opens here. E wave, A wave. Now I have to measure from tricuspid valve closure to opening time. That is 384 milliseconds. See, it's very easy. Next, I go to the pulmonary valve flow in the transgastric view. That is possible only in the transgastric view. So there you get the pulmonary forward flow below the baseline, and you measure this ejection time. So this is nothing but the RV ejection. So you measure the ejection time. Now let us put the figures in the formula. Tricuspid closure to opening time is 384 millisecond minus ejection time 264 millisecond divided by ejection time 264 millisecond. It's wrong. Please excuse me. This will be 264, and you can find out the RV ejection RV index of myocardial performance. Formula is TCO minus ET divided by ET, not the TCO, right? Okay. So by pulse wave Doppler, the abnormal threshold is more than 0.43. So you must remember how to do it. If it is more, the value is higher, we are worried. Then the myocardial performance index is high, means RV systolic function is poor. And we can also calculate the RV index of myocardial performance by tissue Doppler imaging at lateral tricuspid valve annulus. So there we go. This is the E prime, this is A prime, and systolic wave will be at the above the baseline. Now if you look here in the tissue Doppler spectral pattern, before the systolic wave there is a small wave. That is the wave for isovolumic contraction. Similarly, before the E prime, if you see, there is a small wave. That is the isovolumic relaxation time. So you can measure here directly the isovolumic contraction time as well as the isovolumic relaxation time, and then put in the formula. And the ejection time is systole, so it should be from here to here. Or else what you can do, just like tricuspid closure to opening time, you can measure the closure to opening time from here to here, and then you subtract the ejection time which starts from here to here, and you get a value by TDI. It has been given by the latest guidelines that abnormal threshold is 0.54, a bit higher than the pulse wave Doppler. Okay, it is given in the latest guidelines, so you can follow it. But remember, this is unreliable when the RA pressure is elevated, as it shortens the IVRT, right? Because we will be measuring the IVRT, so it may be elevated. That will change the IVRT value. Do you want to go through the regurgitant volume? Okay, by PISA method. A bit of calculation is there, but don't worry, I will show it step by step. So it will be very easy. Now see, when we get the mitral valve regurgitation, this is the mid-esophageal four chamber view. This is LA and this is LV. So MR is going through it. So as the MR flow converges towards the orifice through which it will go, it forms hemispherical structures. There are multiple webs as it goes and narrows towards the orifice from LV to LA. By somehow, we'll have to find out the nearest, the most proximal hemisphere. So let us see how do we do that step by step. First of all, as you get the mitral regurgitation, you do a continuous web Doppler and get a spectral pattern like this, where you trace, that will give you the peak velocity and the VTI. These will need in the formula, because the formula goes like this: 2 pi pizza r square, which I am going to show you in the next slide how we find out the pizza radius, and the aliasing velocity also I am going to show you, and the velocity of MR jet, that we are already having it. And what is the formula of regurgitant volume? It is the ERO multiplied by VTI of MR. Do we have the VTI of MR? Yes, we have. So we have velocity of MR for ERO and we have VTI of MR for volume. We know the value of pi. We have to calculate the pizza radius and aliasing velocity. So as you get the mitral regurgitation in the mid-esophageal four chamber view, put the color flow and you shift the color baseline to a lower level. How low? It should be 30 to 40 centimeter per second. So how much it is here? Minus 38.5, right? So we are within 40 centimeters. Now why do we reduce this aliasing velocity? These will identify the most proximal hemisphere. How? It will form an interface of color. Okay, see here the red and the yellow, right? So you know this is the most proximal hemisphere, and you take the radius from the central point to the peak. This is the pizza radius. And to get the most proximal hemisphere, we need to reduce so that there is an interface. We identify the pizza, proximal isovelocity surface area. Then we take the radius. So now if we look at the formula of ERO, 2 pi r square into aliasing velocity divided by velocity of MR jet. We have the value for pi, we have the value for radius, how much it is? 0.85 centimeter. We have the aliasing velocity, how much it is? 38.5. We have the velocity of the MR jet, which I have shown you in the previous slide. So it goes like this: 2 pi 0.85 square into 38.5, and the whole thing is divided by 538. All the measurements are taken into in centimeters, mind it. If your velocity comes in meter, convert it into centimeter and put the values. See, all are in centimeter. Here it is centimeter, here it is centimeter, and here also the velocity of the MR jet is in centimeter. So the ERO will be 0.32 centimeter square. Now if you have the ERO, you can calculate the regurgitant volume by multiplying ERO with VTI of MR, which I have shown already in the previous slide. It was 172. So the regurgitant volume is 56 ml, right? In severe MR, ERO is more than 0.40 square centimeter, and regurgitant volume is more than 60 cc, I mean ml or cc, whatever. So it's close to moderately severe, you see. If you look at the MR, it's not, if you look at the vena contracta, it doesn't look severe, but it is quite significant. So it fits into moderately severe mitral regurgitation. So is it clear to you?
Please.
Yes, eccentric, yeah, it's not wall hugging. When the jet is wall hugging, you cannot do the pizza. There you have to go by vena contracta. Vena contracta is applicable even in the wall hugging jet also. See, the wall hugging jet is to be considered severe unless proven otherwise. It is to be considered severe. This is not exactly wall hugging, it's a bit eccentric, but if you see, there is a space in between the posterior wall of the LA and the MR. So PISA is mostly applicable in the central jet. Okay, I think I should stop. Too many calculations. Previous slide, okay. Any question? Hmm? Pizza. From the beginning, pizza? Oh, quick, okay, okay, okay. So, we measure the regurgitant volume by the pizza method. Now, this is the MR. Now, as the mitral regurgitation flow converges towards the regurgitant orifice, it forms multiple hemispheres. Waves, yes, hemispheres. So it is going from LV to LA, but are you able to identify the most proximal hemisphere here? Though it is forming a spontaneous pizza, but it is a bit difficult. The interface is not so clear between blue and the red. So first, after doing CW Doppler, getting velocity and VTI, though all were in meter, all were converted into centimeter, we reduce the velocity now to 30 to 40. And as we reduce, this interface of yellow and red becomes very clear. You try in your machine, you reduce the baseline to 30 to 40, it will be very clear, the interface. And from that interface to the center point where you measure the vena contracta, flow converges and then diverges, right? So from the point of convergence to the interface, you take the radius. Not in this way. This is the radius of the pizza, because the wave is formed inside the LV, right? Near the orifice as it is going towards the LA, right? So you measure the radius, you know the aliasing velocity, you know the velocity of MR jet, you know the VTI of MR jet. Only you have to put into the formula. The machine has the formulas. You have to get the variables. You have to feed the variables into the machine to get the value of regurgitant volume. You try in your machine, as you get the AMR, you first do the CW, get the velocity and VTI. Don't forget to convert all the values into centimeter. Then you go and reduce the aliasing velocity, measure the radius. Machine will give you the value. But you must know how important it is, because if you measure in millimeter, in meter, it will not give. You will have to convert into centimeter. Clear? Anything else? Any